want to be mad when we still don't have the equity that we want in the world, and we still don't have the things that we need. Like, what incentive does the man or the oppressor have if you're going to continue to stay at the plantation? If you're going to decide that you're not going to leave? That's what I feel like Kanye was trying to get at.
If Kanye West is a self-proclaimed genius, and he has made his career off of sound bites, he understands the importance of words.
It's over the course of like 10 months where he was getting on stage, just ran. And we were entertained. We was like, yeah, Kanye talking that talk.
Right.
But he was, that was a cry for help.
To come back to the NFL point, the choice, it seems easy enough, right? But I don't play in the NFL.
Oh.
And so I can't tell nobody in the NFL to risk your job because I can't pay your bill. So I understand the dilemma there. But
ties into what you're talking about the bag.
Yeah.
It goes back to the bag.
But it's not just the bag. It's about security, too. I'm just talking about, like, even we had the conversation all the time.
This is America.
It's warfare. It's mental warfare.
He's basically explaining that, too, by the way.
Yeah, we can bring him in, too. Yeah, that's a whole different conversation. Yeah, we can't keep jumping.
We got let's nail this point home. Is that I'm not going to ask somebody to risk their jobs, but you have to understand this, is that the reason why, this is my opinion, and I'm sorry, guys, because y'all don't have to care anything about what I'm about to say right now. Y'all can exclude yourself from that. But the reason why I feel like we as a people have not been freed is because we lack conviction. Like, we completely lack conviction in terms of, I'm not going to boycott the NFL because I like the Patriots. We started last year, right, with Colin Kaepernick. How successful was that protest? Like,
it was very successful.
I think it was successful.
Well, very successful.
But the views and all that stuff went down.
It was successful to the point where the NFL decided that, you know what, we're going to make sure y'all Negroes do not stand.
But this is where the choice comes into play.
Right. New slaves.
Am I going to abide by this rule and be fine? Or what can we do? Because the NFL is like 80% black, right?
80%.
So what if all of us take
that's the thing. So when you talk about conviction and you talk about everybody, we got to recognize our power in this situation, right? And not just in terms of athletics and the influence that we have there. When we look about our power in voting, right? There were many elections that have been changed by the black vote in and of itself. When we think about our power as consumers, we don't buy all the music like the white race does, but we buy everything else and we drive those things. And so when we get to a place where we recognize our power and we see what kind of influence we have, and we have that conviction, we literally can change the world. It's just a matter of being caught up in this place where we keep getting played against each other by the systems that are in place, and that's what keeps us as these new slaves. I feel like all of us are new slaves in that way, right? Because we all make decisions one way or another based off of this safety or this fear of uncertainty. And so we got to get to a place where we start to have these conversations and we start to empower each other to realize and recognize we got power, man. We just can't be out here because like you said, if all 80% of them players come out and kneel, how many fines is getting sent out?
Hello? Why aren't they kneeling and doing that? Because the bag, man. The bag.
That's the bag.
You're
right.
The bag
is important, though,
it's
man.
It's important, but it's not everything. You know what I'm saying?
And it's not.
My issue is that overwhelming number of black folks go to church every Sunday. Overwhelming number of black folks believe in Jesus Christ.
Don't they?
But when it comes to uncertainties in life and people want that security, it's always, well, I can't do this because it's going to affect, you know, my job and my money and my family. What about the God that you claim to pray to every night or wake up and pray to every morning?
Talk about
you go to church on Sunday and worship.
He's not giving us the spirit of what?
Do y'all hear
what I'm saying? You know, in cash it cares, and it says, I give you the power to obtain wealth.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It says it in the Bible. It says it in Scripture. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So when do we Why did we stop following that and start and start to trust in our abilities on the field or our abilities in the workplace? And if we don't perform at a certain level, if we do something that that goes against the oppressor or management or whatever, we're going to lose our job security, and I can't afford to do that.
That goes back to my point about conviction, is that we don't have it, like, in totality.
They don't have it. I have it.
If we're talking about group, you know, we're talking about African as a community, right? And you talk about the larger percentage of individuals who believe in this said religion and God to be able to provide for them. If the conviction was there that I really do believe this and I'm going to stand on what I believe, then I can take a knee and I'm not worried about losing my job. I can protest this right now. I can do this and I can operate in my full strength because I have the conviction in my beliefs. And I also have the conviction that I understand that whatever larger power or being is there is going to be able to maintain and keep me through it, you know?
I agree.
But I think too, though, a lot of times we haven't... as a black, the black community, we haven't protected those people who advocate for us.
Go ahead.
Like, we haven't really sheltered them and made sure that they are taken care of. So, time and time again, we have these movements, we have these protests, and we have these figures that really lose their jobs and their way of life and quality to provide for their families. And what happens?
It's a cycle. We're going to get a lot of kickback for this episode.
And that's fine.
I appreciate it.
What's the guy named who did Nat Turner?
Nate Parker. Nate Parker.
Have you heard anything else from Nate Parker?
No, because they silenced him.
Yeah, but this one you're talking about.
Are we protecting him?
Yeah. Right.
Well,
we needed that.
So let me say this, though. Let me say this, because I think
you gotta wrap it up.
For the faith part, I mean, I get it, and I know that everybody that talks about God and talks about Jesus, the thing that I get stuck up on and that, because I agree with both of you guys what you're saying, but everybody not at that place in their faith to have that boldness and that courage, right? And so I don't want to come at them for where they're at in their walk and be like, you know, this is what you need to be doing, because I feel like that's what happens to them at the church all the time. Like, they just get browbeat about not walking in that faith. And there are many greats in the Bible who, you know, question God or question what he said to do. So there's that piece. Mm-hmm. I think the other piece, though, specifically with, like, the NFL, is that it is the bag. It's the security. It's when you get to the NFL, many of them go broke because they take care of so many people, which is a great thing for the people that they're taking care of, but a bad thing for them in security long term. Mm-hmm. But the other piece is, I think that on top of the money, it's just that nobody's talking and leading them together and getting them together so that nobody feels like they're going to do it alone. I think that's what, for me, I think that's what the biggest thing that's like maintaining their fear is, like, I don't want to do it if everybody ain't going to do it. Yeah. Because, you know, if the person that's making the 10 million, 20 million ain't doing it, I definitely don't want to do it at 250,000 because I got a lot more to lose than you, right? And so I think if we get to a place where somebody, and Colin had to go out like that. Like, we don't know what he's doing or what kind of money he's getting. We know he's getting all these awards and doing a lot of great work, but he had to be the sacrificial lamb in that space. Yeah. And that's unfair to him. And I feel like his brothers in the NFL need to step up and support him in that way. And if all of them get to that place, I feel like that's when we realize the power that we have and the conviction. And I feel like we also can see that that's what it's going to take to make the change, if that makes sense.
End of the day, I'm from Louisville, Kentucky, and you all know who the greatest is, right? Muhammad Ali.
Yeah.
Muhammad Ali, in the prime of his career, said, you know what? I'm not going to no war, man. Them folks ain't did nothing to me. Muhammad Ali died. Did you see the funeral, the processional? Folks was running down that man's street, streets named after him. You know, people are chanting his name. Why? Because he's the greatest, because he stood for something bigger than sports. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And he took that risk, and he went down as the greatest. Colin Kaepernick, I'm not comparing anything to Muhammad Ali, but
what he's doing.
Is going to be up there to the thing, to how Ali is being looked at. Yeah. Ali's been looked at as an athlete, but more so than a greater person and an advocate for those less fortunate.
Yeah. See, I think I've seen a picture of Muhammad Ali, Hakeem Olajuwon, Jim Brown.
Yeah.
Like, but it was a different time where black people stick together.
Yeah.
Black athletes stuck together.
For sure.
And we need to get back to that.
We have to bring this to a close.
And it wasn't about money.
There's a lot of things that we can say too, because it also makes you think that
you still get the bag.
You know, people beyond the bag is that people have staked their lives, their hopes, their dreams, and everything into a moment in time in which they became football players, right? But I often ask myself this question, that if I was there during the heights of the civil rights movement, what would I do? You know, would I be with King? Would I be with Rosa Parks? Or would I be marching and Malcolm and whomever? And Now this is our current civil rights, and we realize that the reality is this, that back then everybody couldn't be out there protesting. Somebody had to go to work. Somebody had to do other things. So it's like, it's more complicated than just a simple conversation. It's bigger than just some buzzwords or a snippet. And like, we understand that it goes back to Jim Crow laws, right? And slavery, when slaves weren't allowed to convene. Because they know if they convene, they'll get together and have a conversation.
Yeah, but don't, well, see, now, I know we about to end, but we can't give these brothers this out. Like, I can't do it. I was an athlete all the way up through college, competed professionally a little bit, semi-pro. I feel like what you're saying is like giving them an out. And I feel like I hear what you're saying. I get it. But in 2018, we can't keep giving them this out, because what that type of rhetoric does is it keeps us enslaved and it keeps us powerless in that way, because we keep giving people the out. Now, I'm not saying that everybody gonna jump on. I'm not saying that everybody gonna do it, but we can't keep saying, oh, somebody gotta go. Nah, either you gonna get in, or what they say is state property, get down or lay down, right?
Get down or
and
lay down.
So we gotta move away from that. Like, back in slavery time, we understand the conditioning that took place and why people felt like they couldn't get to that point. We understand the civil rights here, you know, but like all these examples that we got, and we see the success that happened from those things, I'm not at the place in 2018 where I'm saying, okay, let's not do that. Who does it? Those who want to do it, those who don't, nah. When they marched across that bridge in Selma, they was out there in the masses and they got changed. Mm-hmm. Whether you agree with the method or not, whether you agree, if you was an ex or you was a king or whoever, they came together and they did something. So these NFL players to come together and do something, because I'm not for this, or you can keep your job, whatever. It's more to athletics, and I think that's the other thing now, because we're not going to be sitting up here telling black men that all they're good for is athletics. If you lose your job on the football field, cool, go get another job, right? And I know it's not that easy, but I'm just saying, like, let's empower these brothers to recognize that we're going to support them and we're going to hold them down, and that they got power, because the more we sell them and relegate them to just athletes, we feeding the system, and I'm not for that.
But look, let us know what y'all think. Comment below.
Because it's time to continue the conversation.
We all want you to engage with 6 Degrees of Black Mental Health, and we appreciate you watching.
You ain't gonna let
and him, we ain't responding to your individual comments at us, all right?
Sorry, we can't. But you know, put your comments up there. But you ain't gonna leave me on this episode like this. Right. Like, nah, I'm giving them out. That's not what I was saying.
You was.
And, no, I was trying to speak to the reality.
You was.